Welcome, friends, to this three-day event in Newport Beach. I'm very happy to be back here and to meet so many of you, my old friends and some new friends. It's always nice to meet friends. Friendship is a rare thing. We meet acquaintances, but very few friends. We meet a lot of people who we can say are friends. But then we find that friendship is based on love. And love is something which is unconditional. When you love somebody, there are no conditions attached to it. But we find that most of our friendship lasts so long as we keep on getting what we expect. If we don't get what we expect, friendship ends, love ends. This kind of love is not called true love. True love is unconditional and very rare to find. But one place you can always find true love is in your relationship with a perfect living master. A perfect living master is a human being like us. No difference. He's born like us, lives like us, dies like us. His whole karma is like us. He falls sick, he goes to hospital. He eats the diet that suits him. Sometimes he gets fat and he wants to lose weight, just like us. No difference. The only difference between a perfect living master and ourselves is his state of awareness. What does he know? How much is he aware in his head? We are aware of very little of the total existence. We are aware of what is around us. We use our sense perceptions to be aware of things around us in this physical world. We know very little of the physical world. Every year new telescopes are being developed and we find the world is bigger than we thought. There are several galaxies, more galaxies, billions of galaxies being discovered every time there's a new telescope put in the space. Similarly, in terms of small things, the smaller this world becomes and we go through microscopes, the best microscopes, we find there is so much world which we can't see. In a small little place, the gut bacteria, the trillions of population living inside each body of ours, all living beings living there, so little knowledge we have, even of the outside world. And then what is inside us? We have no idea. Where are emotions coming from? Where thinking is coming from? What is our mind? What is the substance of which the mind is made of? What is life made of? Does soul create life? Is there such a thing as a soul? Anybody has seen? You may never have seen a soul, and yet you're all alive because of soul. We have such little knowledge. But a perfect living master has knowledge, so much knowledge, that we could not even contain it if we found out. Because his knowledge is not based upon only being in a physical body. We have more than one body. We are living now in a physical body, but inside this physical body is another body which creates our sense perceptions. We use it every day. We use it when we imagine things. We imagine something and we can see it. These eyes are not seeing it. Something inside is seeing it. We say it's our mind seeing, our imagination is seeing. But seeing is different from seeing with these eyes. Similarly, we can touch, taste, smell, have all the sense perceptions without this physical body. So there is something else of which we have very little knowledge. People who have been able to die while living, that means while they are still in the body, but they have been able to experience what happens to us after death. They know there is a body that survives after death, and that body has all the sense perceptions that we have here. So therefore, there is more knowledge inside than we are aware of. That's not all. We don't know that the mind is also a body. We think mind is merely a function of the brain. It just provides thinking. But if you were not having a physical body, If you were not having sense perceptions, but were still alive, you would find that the mind is also a body. We are not aware of it. But some yogis, some masters, have been able to die even in the inner body while living, and they are able to know that the mind is also a body which creates everything, all experiences. Perfect living masters know even more. They even know that if there was no mind, no senses, no body, we are still alive. And that is how they know the soul is immortal and is alive, no matter you have these bodies or not. This knowledge, this awareness is with these perfect living masters at all times. It is not that they have gone one day into meditation and seen something and come back to tell us, which we can. If we do meditation and see something and come back here, we say, I had a very good experience. But perfect living masters have that experience continuously, 24/7, all the time. When they come to us and speak to us, they are not speaking from anything they remember. They are speaking from what they are aware of at that very moment when they are speaking. Because they have this awareness 24/7 of every level of creation, every level of consciousness, including our true home, to which we born, from where the souls came, which we call Satchkhand or true home. Their awareness sits in all the regions at the same time when they are here. It's a very big difference. As a human being, they are like us. In awareness, they are full of all the knowledge that we can ever get. So that makes a big difference. That is why we say we are all one, but we don't really believe it because we look different, we speak different language. Sometimes we like each other, sometimes we don't. But perfect living masters have seen we are all one. Not that they believe, they've seen it. And therefore, their love for us is unconditional. And their friendship is the highest friendship that is possible. Do these perfect living masters come here to teach us something? No, not at all. They are not teachers at all. Because there are thousands of teachers available. Why should they also do the same thing that is already being done by so many people? There, people are teaching all the time about soul, about these things, meditation, everything. If you're not teachers, there are books, thousands of books in every language telling us the same thing. Perfect living master don't come for that. They come here in response to our seeking. We seek inside. They are at that level where they can see our seeking. And when they find that there is a seeker wanting to go to their true home above the mind, they appear in front of them as an ordinary human being. They appear by coincidence, they appear by chance, they appear by circumstances created, and it looks like it was a strange coincidence how they appeared, but they appear. We can't find them because they look just like us. How can we find them? We can't read what is inside the head of a person. Therefore, they appear in our life and they come to take us back to our true home, which is what we are seeking. If we are not seeking that, they won't come. Then other masters come to respond to what we are seeking. Supposing we are seeking some better life here, there are many coaches, many people who can come and tell us that. Supposing you want to learn how to meditate to get calmness, peace of mind, so many yogis, masters are available for that. Perfect living masters. Why do we call them perfect living masters? Because all imperfection in this world is created by the mind. Above the mind, there is no imperfection. So since these perfect living masters operate from above the mind, we call them perfect. They are living because they are living as a human being. Therefore, they are perfect living masters. They are not dead masters. What is the difference between a living master and a dead master? A perfect living master who has died, why can't he help us? If he is really perfect and is still available in some spiritual form, and we call him in spirit, why can't he inform us? Because there is no way we can distinguish between our mind telling us something and what we think the master is telling us. I meet so many people, especially in this country, who tell me we are being guided by ascended masters from the Himalayas. and they are living there in the caves. I say, have you ever gone and seen them? No. But they guide us in spirit from inside. I said, I have gone and seen them. And they say, we don't guide anybody there. You go and ask them, they say, tell you, we don't guide anybody. They are all living there. I have seen the living form, and they don't guide anybody here. They say, those who claim that we are guiding them are being guided by their minds. And the minds are making up this whole story that we are getting guidance from somewhere else. What is wrong with that? If the mind is guiding us, what is wrong? What is wrong is the mind always wants to involve us more and more in outward activity in the external physical world. And why is mind adopted that? Because for lifetime after lifetime, all we have done in our birth in physical world is to desire things of this world, get attached to them, and ask more and more of them. This attachment and desire has kept us coming back here, and the mind loves that. The mind gets attached, and therefore the guided instructions we get attaches us more to this world than anything else. If you find out what they have guided you, they guided you about the physical world. They have not guided you about your true home ever. Nobody has said, leave the mind. Nobody who is saying, I am being guided by your spirit, has ever said that the spirit has said, leave this. This is not your place. You belong to somewhere else. But perfect living masters, those who are alive, can say, what you are thinking is not right. They can say no to the mind, which the mind won't say no to itself. And that is why it's very necessary, if you want to go above the mind, if you want to go to your true home, a perfect living master is necessary. You don't have to find him, just seek him. Seek inside. You don't have to shout for it. Don't have to go and pray in any particular place. You have to seek inside your own self wherever you are. There's no special temple or church or cathedral or somewhere you have to go pray for some kind of guidance inside. There is no greater temple than the temple of a living body. All religions have said the same thing, but we still go to man-made temples and churches and other places of worship. The real place of worship is this human body inside. And you will see that the head of the human body is the most important part of the human body. All awareness is stored here. And it is only when you go in here that you get true knowledge, including the knowledge of your true home. When we are seekers of our true home, these masters appear, and what do? They pull us with their love. Because love lies beyond the mind. They don't pull us with their conversation or argument or try to persuade us. It's not necessary. When somebody is pulled by love, the ego goes, sits back, and is so enchanted by the love one is experiencing, one is pulled by that. That is the way one crosses the mind. Not by using the mind. You can't cross the mind by using more of the mind. You can't cross the mind by thinking more about it. That is why intellectual activity has its limitation. It only keeps you within the realm of the mind, whereas the love that pulls is beyond the mind and takes you even beyond the mind to your true home. These perfect living masters have come here to pull our souls with their love and take them back home. They know who they have to take back home, and they appear in the lives of those people, take them back home. As it happens, while they are doing their work to take back home the souls that have sought them, for whom they have come, and this big, big world of billions of people, several seekers spread all over, when a perfect living master comes in a human form, he is limited in scope, how many people he can meet, how many people he can take. That is why every perfect living master who has come has had his own list of souls to take back home for whom he came in the area in which he could work. So it has happened all over the world, just like that. So they will pick up their marked sheep, like a shepherd collects marked sheep, that these are my sheep, they are marked for me, I have to take them back home. Masters act like that. But while they are doing this work, Many other people get a chance to see them. What happens when you see a perfect living master and you are not a marked heap? What happens? The impact of their awareness, the impact of their soul is so much that we get marked. May not be marked for the same master, but we get marked. That is why they say having a look at a human being who is a perfect living master, even once, is a guarantee you will get marked and one day you will go back home. Looking at the face of a master, we call in India darshan of a master. The value of darshan is immense. It will one day happen if you have had a darshan of a perfect living master that you will automatically, the seeking will come in you after that. And maybe this life, next life, sometime later, you will be taken back home again. So that is a big thing also for those who are not marked. So I sometimes call that there's list A, list B, and list A goes with the same master, list B goes for future masters. But this is a very big value. In India, they try to explain a lot of things in terms of stories. I'll tell you one story. I heard it in India, that there was one somewhat enlightened man called Narad Muni. He was a good guy. He had some access to higher God, Brahma, Vishnu, at that level. He could go to that level and have a conversation with them. But he was also a little naughty. They say that he used to carry tales from one house to the other. And sometimes he would create problems amongst people, which he enjoyed watching as a show. So there's both sides of that man. But one day, Narad Muni was walking, and he used to go from place to place, begging for food and so on. So one day he was walking, and he saw a crowd of people running. He said, "Where are you running?" They said, "A perfect living master has come into our village. We are going to have his darshan." He said, "What does that mean? Is he going to give you anything?" "No, we're just going to see him. That is called darshan. You're going to have a darshan of a perfect living master." He said, "What a stupid thing. People are running to see a man. What can I get out of it? It means nothing to go and just see a man. If he's going to give a talk or giving some knowledge, giving some prasad, giving something, one can go. But just to go to look at a person, what value does it have?" So he went into his meditation and he manifested his Isht Brahma. And he said, "Brahmaji, I have a question. Today I saw a lot of people running to see the face of a man they call perfect living master and they call it darshan. What is the value of darshan?" And Brahmaji said, "Oh, that's a deep question. I would like you, Narad Muni, you go to a neighboring village and see there will be a snake in with his head up in the pond of that village. The snake will give you an answer to that question." So Narad Muni went, and he went to that village and he saw a pond of water, and there was really a snake there, his head up in the water. And he said, "Mr. Snake, I have come to ask you, what is the value of darshan, looking at the face of a master?" And the snake dropped its head and died. He said, "What kind of answer is that?" Went into meditation again and said, "Brahmaji, you told me the snake will give an answer. Snake never gave an answer, he died." "Oh, I'm sorry to hear that." Brahmaji said, "I'm very sorry to hear that. I think you should go to another village, a little distant. You travel for a while. There is a goldsmith and he has just bought a new parrot. The parrot is in a cage. You go and ask this question from the parrot, he'll give you an answer. Parrots can speak." So he traveled to that village, took some days and reached there. And he found out, "Is there a goldsmith in the village?" "Yes." He went to his house. "Do you have a parrot?" "I just got a new parrot, very nice one. Can I have a conversation with the parrot?" "Oh, Narad Muni, you wanting to talk to a parrot must be a very lucky parrot." He said, "I want to just ask a question." So the parrot was brought to him, and he said, "Mr. Parrot, what is the value of this darshan, looking at the face of a person they call a perfect living master?" And the parrot dropped his head and died. He said, "What kind of game is this that Brahmaji is playing with me?" He went into meditation again and said, "Brahmaji, what is this game? I asked the snake died. Now you sent me to a parrot, the parrot died." And Brahmaji said, "Oh, I'm sorry to hear that. That's very sad. I'll tell you now. Go to another country, far off, new state. And it'll take you some while. But don't mind. When you reach there, you go to the palace of the king and ask them if a newborn baby has been born there. And ask that baby, he'll give you the answer." Now Narad Muni was shivering and trembled. "Parrot and snake is all right. I hope nothing happened to the baby." But he traveled. And he went traveled for several months and eventually reached that kingdom. And he went, and the king recognized him and said, "Narad Muni, you come to this place." He said, "I have come for a very special purpose. Has your wife, the queen, given birth to a baby?" "Oh, yes, she gave birth to a baby boy just a few days back. I would like to see the baby." "Most welcome, very blessed baby to have Narad Muni coming to see him." Narad Muni is inside, not so sure if it's a blessing or not. But anyway, he said, "I'd like to see the baby in privacy." They said, "Certainly. We'll withdraw. You go and see the baby in that room." Narad Muni went there and said, "Mr. Baby, I have come to ask you a simple question. What is the value of darshan, looking at the face of a master?" And the baby spoke. He said, "Narad Muni, I am the same snake you saw. I am the same parrot that you saw. You are not a perfect living master, just a muni. But even at your rank, your darshan cut short my life as a snake, made me into a bird. Your second darshan cut short my life as a bird, made me into a human being. In the case of a perfect living master, the value of darshan is 1,000 times more." That's how he got the answer. Sometimes we have these stories to tell simple truths, that the value actually is far greater than is described in the story. The value is, if you have a darshan of a perfect living master, you will become marked to go back to your true home, and you become a seeker automatically. Sometimes we wonder, what is making us seek the truth? We are happy living in this world, and we see something is missing. Something is not right. This doesn't seem to be my place. Where do these thoughts come? This is a place of pain and pleasure. This is not my place. I don't belong here. Where do these ideas come from? That seeking comes from not the mind, soul. Very often the mind and the soul are saying different things to us. The soul is seeking to get out and go back to true home. The mind is trying to attach us more and more to this world. And we are being guided so much by the mind that the soul remains suppressed most of the time. But when seeking exceeds a certain point, "No, I have to seek. What is inside? What is the truth? Where do I belong?" When that seeking comes, a perfect living master appears in our life. And it's amazing the timing of the seeking, how seeking grows. It reaches a certain point, perfect living master comes. Mind fights. "No, he's just an ordinary person. Don't think he's come for helping you in any way. How can a man help you?" And in any case, he's saying, others are saying, that God and the truth is inside you. Your true home is inside you. If it's inside you, find inside, not outside from another man. If you have God right inside you, why do you need a third party, an intermediary, to go outside to find out something that is inside you? How can a person outside you tell you what is inside you? Go inside and find out. The problem is, when we try to go inside, we don't know what is inside. We have really no idea. Sometimes we think, by closing our eyes, we are inside. Closing our eyes only means we don't see what is outside, does not mean we are inside at all. Therefore, we meditate, we are meditating outside. We close our eyes, we think we have gone somewhere, no, we are still there. We have not gone anywhere inside, we have no idea what is inside, we have never gone there. Then somebody says, no, there are several centers inside, real centers of energy. All the energies, all the frequencies that create all experiences are inside, and we go to those centers inside. We put our attention on different centers, and the centers give us some strange experiences. No center gives us our true home. People have tried for thousands of years. I sat with the yogis who were practicing for all their life, and I did the same meditation with them in the mountains. And none of them had ever gone to their true home. All they had is strange experiences, out-of-body experiences, running here and there, going where? Outside of themselves, not inside. It has taken me so much time to understand that inside is different from the experience of the energy centers. They're running our life outside and inside. So just by putting your attention on these energy centers, we are not going anywhere inside. We focus our attention on anything, it's always outside. We never focus attention on ourselves. And why can't we do it? Because we have never been told how you can know your inside your own self. We do not know what our self is. We are thinking our body is our self. Sometimes thought comes, maybe there's an Atma, there is some soul inside, and that is making us alive. We don't know where it is. Sometimes people who practice the yoga of the six chakras below, they think the Atma is sitting in these chakras. These are all energy centers. How can the very source of creation, the very source of life, sit in these? Energy is not the same as life. Life is much wider. So that is why these questions come up. How can we find what is our own self inside? But those who have taught us how to go inside, like perfect living masters tell us, the self which creates the experience, that is your inside, not the experience, no matter what. You can have the highest experience, it's an experience, not yourself. Who are you? The experiencer of that experience. We never know the experiencer, we know the experience. All our life, we led our life like that. We have led maybe millions of lives like that. Never had a chance to know who is experiencing all that. We are so caught up in experience, we never know who is having it. I can say that my body is having an experience of physical world, but who is in the body accepting it? When body is dead, it can have no experience. What is life? Where is life coming from? Then we say the sensory systems are getting all the experience. Yes, but who is picking up from the sensory systems? They say our thinking is coming. Thoughts may be creating something. Yes, thoughts, but who is thinking? The mind is not thinking by itself. Who is accepting the thoughts? Who is using the mind and thinking? We don't know. That is why it is so difficult to know who the self is, who our real self is. Socrates said, know thyself. People have said, if you can know yourself, you have known God. Because God sits inside the self. So the self is not known. That is why we need somebody who has known the self to guide us. And that's a perfect living master outside of ourselves. But does he teach us to look outside? If he says, you go to that river and have a bath and you will find out who you are, don't get that blunder. River don't contain the self. Self is inside us. If somebody says, rise to the mountain and it will give you the knowledge of the self, no way. And no buildings in the world can exist which can give you that, no matter by what name you call them. The only way to know the self is where the self is operating from, which is inside. And at different times, it may look like the self is not in one place. We think we carry the self in the body, we run around, are we carrying the self also? Looks like that. What will we find when we find the self? The self created the experience of the body, self created the experience of the body running, but never ran itself. It's a very interesting knowledge we get by trying to understand the self. The self that lies inside cannot be accessed by focusing attention on anything. People say, but I focus attention on myself. I ask them, how do you do it? They say, I close my eyes and I imagine I am at the third eye center. The highest of the six centers behind the eyes. I say, how do you go to the third eye center? So I close my eyes and see myself sitting there. And then I know I can focus myself on myself sitting there. I said, do you see yourself? Yes, I do. Then are you what you are seeing? Are you the one who is seeing? Are you the seer? Or are you the what is seen? You are always assuming what you are seeing is yourself. How can it be separate from you? The one that sees the image in meditation is not knowing who the seeing person is. But what you are seeing, you are thinking that is yourself. You are making up an artificial self. Not only that, the biggest blunder is to, because your eyes are closed, you think you are seeing that made up stuff inside. You are making it up outside these eyes even. And I give simple example when these yogis used to talk to me that we are looking at ourselves inside and we are sitting with the same bhavuti inside, we are having the same fire inside. So can you see all that? Yes, we can. Okay, now you see them and I'll give you an experiment. I gave them an experiment that without seeing that, can you touch your eyes, physical eyes? Yes, with our hands we can touch our eyes. Now close your eyes and see that and then bring your eyes close slowly to your eyes. And when they would raise their hand, say, are you quite close to where you're seeing? Yes, now. Or we just cross them. They were seeing just outside. They're trying to see with the same eyes. They're trying to see with astral inner eyes, which are located same place as these eyes. And images they are making in the head are all outside. We are not going inside at all. I tell you the difficulty. Difficulty is we have learned how to focus our attention. We read a book, we have to focus attention. We speak to people, we have to focus attention. Focusing attention always takes the attention outside of ourselves, not inside. That's the meaning of focusing attention, to go away from yourself, to what you are focusing attention on. To know who you are, you have to do something different, called withdrawing attention to yourself, not focusing. Big mistake we make it even in meditation. Withdrawal of attention to yourself is very different from focusing attention on anything, including what you think is yourself. And this distinction between focusing attention and withdrawing attention is so subtle and so important, we miss it. People have spent 30, 40, 50 years, whole life, trying to meditate by focusing attention on something outside or what they think is inside by closing the eyes, and they are always outside. Never had any chance to know what the inside, what the self is. If you withdraw attention to yourself, that means attention should be where you are, wherever you are, wherever you think you are. It is only in the wakeful state in a human body that we think we are in the head behind the eyes. It doesn't mean it's always there. Only in wakeful state, because we go to sleep every night. Where you go to sleep, where are the self? Where is the self? Where do we think we are? In the wakeful state, we think we are just a unit of awareness, just picking up awareness. We can say it's behind the eyes. We're looking out of the eyes, we feel we are there, hands are below us, heart is below us, all other organs are below us, and we are in the head at the eye level. Just because of seeing, we feel the self is at the eye level behind. What happens when we go to sleep? We don't know, we are unaware of the body. But if we were to be half asleep and we're able to know where are we in the body. Sometimes the sleep is very coming up and we are sleepy, you will see it is not behind the eyes, it's dropping down. I give experiment to people. At night, when you are about to sleep and feeling very sleepy, try to touch your eyes, physical eyes, and they touch their nose and they think they're touching the eyes. Then already the location of the so-called self, where you are, is dropping down. When you're having dreams, it's down to the throat. When you're deep sleep and you think no dreams are taking place, drops to the heart. When you're waking up, it jumps up. When you're awake, it's back behind the eyes. When you are in deep meditation and experiencing something higher than the physical reality, it's higher up. First it is higher up by going backward, then goes up. Different locations exist for ourself as a unit of consciousness in this physical body. This is the most miraculous body that's been made like this. Not only in terms of physical activity, there's so much of nervous system, other things, system, all the systems are so compactly packed in. But when you see the awareness side, the knowledge side, how much knowledge it is packed, it's even more remarkable how the whole knowledge of the whole creation is packed up right here. Knowledge of God is packed up right in here. Knowledge of the self is packed up right here. It's all in this physical body. There are different positions in the body. When the attention is withdrawn to those places, you get those experiences. Not focused. So withdrawal of attention has to be learnt very differently than what we have learnt so far in focusing attention. So that is why these perfect living masters help us to withdraw attention with their love. And what happens when we follow their simple steps to withdraw attention inside? We find they are not pulling us from outside, they are pulling us from inside. And they appear inside. And we realize for the first time, a perfect living master, because we always look outside, appears outside, he's actually inside us. He's also part of ourself. And supposing we completed our journey and reached our true home, we'll find there was no difference between our true self and a perfect living master we saw outside. It's just a manner of, a method of getting back to our true home, that while we are putting all attention outside, a perfect living master as an ordinary human being appears outside. But he's not outside. In truth, he's inside. So that is why it's the inner master that's pulling us. The feelings that we have of being pulled by love are inside us, but we associate it with a person outside because we don't look inside at all. So this is a simple way to explain to you what is the advantage of following a spiritual path like the one I'm following and which I'm sharing with you. It is, if you are seeking your true home, you will be pulled by a perfect living master who will appear in your life as an ordinary person, but the love will pull you. And that is the biggest sign of a perfect living master. His love pulls you. You don't know where it's pulling from. You don't know why you are attracted. Only the other day I was giving examples of a few people who came to my master, Baba Sawan Singh. And they came to tell him that what he's teaching is not right. There was one professor who used to come to him. He said, "Master, you are making a fool of people. There are no such things as higher regions and higher states. This world is the only thing we have. We are born into it, we die in it, and that's the end of the matter. Life is not existing beyond this life. Nobody has any proof." Oh, we hear people remember near-death experiences outside. Mind can make up any near-death experience. The brain is very powerful. What you think is a very high region is only made up by the mind. Master, don't tell people that there is true home and we have to go to true home. There is no true home. We are here temporarily. We die, we end. Matter end there. No soul, no other thing. Only brain activity we call mind. Senses are built into the organs of the body. That is it. And great master told the professor, "You have every right to think the way you do. That's your information you have. I have different information. So I believe differently. which all depend. We have a right to disagree based on our information which we have. So I believe that these things exist, and I believe we can go to these places beyond the mind even. But if you don't believe, it's all right. You can believe what you like. And the professor went away. Next weekend, he was back again. He said, Master, I've come to tell you, what you are saying is not right. And he repeated the whole thing again. So the master said, no, I explained to you that you have your experience. I have mine. Experience can differ. And I have some experience which is very convincing for me. And you have your experience which is convincing for you. So we rest there are different opinions and different experiences. There's nothing wrong with it. It's all right. Thank you for reminding me. The professor went away. Third week again he came back. And he said, Master, I want to tell you, please don't say those things. And great master said, you know, this is the third time you have come to me, tell me the same thing. Tell me, if you don't believe anything, why are you coming to me? He said, I don't know, but I'd love to come and see you. And later he became one of the best disciples of great master. Love pulls us against the argument of the mind. Only love can override our mind. Otherwise, I don't know anything else that can override our mind. Our mind and thoughts think we know everything. This is final. We know best. Every time we say we know best, when love comes, we don't know best. It overrides our mind. And that is how the perfect living masters operate. It's really their love that pulls us. And at a certain point in time, overrides the mind. The mind becomes an obstacle. Why does the mind become an obstacle? Mind should love it. The reason is the mind feels threatened. The mind feels my existence is at stake because here is somebody who is coming to take beyond the mind and create the fact that mind is not our true home. Thinking is not the final thing. There's something more than thinking in us. And that is why the mind becomes a sort of an obstacle, sometimes a very strong enemy of the soul. Soul wants to go home, mind says no. And then since we have lived our life with the help of the mind, guided by thinking, guided by mind, it takes a lot of time for us, sometimes several lifetimes. It's only many lifetimes when we come to a point, no, we have to go to a true home. This is not the place. This is not the place. This is not the place. The soul is saying. So the soul is what seeks the true home, not the mind. Mind seeks pleasures and joys. And great masters, I've seen perfectly masters sometimes give you those little joyful glimpses inside also, just to induce the mind. Okay, have a look, at least try at least. It's not that the mind is going to be really taken in, but it can stop interfering. So to keep the mind at bay, to keep it away from obstructing us from going to our true home, sometimes masters give us little things like these. So I am only sharing these things with you because I know you are here as seekers of the same truth and we are co-travelers. You are traveling the same path I am traveling. And I thought because of the guidance I have got, I am a little older than most of you. I don't think anyone of you is older than me. Maybe one or two might be there. I am already over 91 years old. So I've had some experience even in this physical body about what is outside, what is inside, and how masters operate. So I'm sharing this because it is not necessary to search for a master. I want to clarify this. Master will search for you. What you have to do is seek inside. Seek, and if you seek, you will find. That's the secret. Seeking inside is the secret. So when you seek inside, your mind will say no. When the opportunity comes to meet a master, mind will find the best arguments not to follow another human being and ask questions and say question after question. And sometimes there are some people, especially very highly intellectual people, they spend their whole life in asking questions. Great master used to give a little story of a professor, intellectual man, visiting a village in India, a small village, and those villages have wells where there is no parapet wall around them. They are at level with the ground. So as he was walking, thinking of something about his own matter somewhere, he fell into the well. Fortunately, the well was shallow in water. He didn't drown, but he was shouting, wailing, crying for help. And he said, why did he fall into the well? A man who was walking outside, a villager, he heard a man has fallen into the well and he could hear his groaning and moaning. So he came and he said, oh, I'm sorry you fell into the well. Don't worry. I'll go to my house and bring a rope and I'll lower the rope and you can hold it and I'll pull you out or you can come up on the rope. The professor said, wait before you go. First explain to me, how did I fall into the well? And then explain to me, how can I trust you that you will bring a rope? Thirdly, how can I know that if you bring the rope, that after I'm holding it, you will not drop me again? The villager said, if I take you out of the well and answer these questions, will it not be better? First come out of the well and then we can talk how you fell, what happened. He said, no, I can't let you go. You must answer my questions first. All the answers must come before you go. And then you stay in the well. Villager said, I didn't know that you want to stay in the well. Do you know we seekers are sometimes like that? We have to get our answers to our questions. We can't take one step forward. First, I must get all the answers to my questions. And questions are such, when I ask a question, an answer comes, a second question comes from the answer, third question. I have seen people living with questions most of their life. And they die before they get an answer. There is a time, even when the mind is asking questions, to say, let me try one step. After all, if I take one step, I'll get part of the answer. Is it true that there is something on the spiritual way or to go back to our true home? If the first step is not working, I'll come back. But no, I must ask and have my answers questioned in the mind only. And that can be another problem for us. We question too much. We keep on asking questions. How do the perfectly living masters attend to this mind that is asking questions? First, they start giving answers to questions. Like if they are also on the same level like us, they have also grappled with the same questions and therefore they are giving answers they found. And we say, no, those are not the answers, right answers. So we ask more, they give more answers. And then we are being pulled by love while they are doing this. Then the question disappear. We are not interested in the questions. We are interested in going home with the love that is pulling us. That's the method they follow. And we all experience it that way. So these are some of the things I can share with you. Because I was a bigger skeptic than anyone I've met. I had more questions than anybody I know. And how these questions were dealt with, not by more questions than answers, but by the pull of love, which showed that the questions were manufactured by the mind to keep me away from my truth, not to help me to go to the truth. And this is not known to us, that the mind is working in a way to perpetuate its own dominance on the soul, on ourselves, for our life. And the mind has dominated so much that we have forgotten that the soul is also operating inside us. Love never comes from the mind. Love comes from the soul, no matter what love is. Love is a function of soul, even here, now. When you think, you can never think yourself into love. Love comes, then you can think about it and sometimes destroy it also by thinking too much. Similarly, there's another function of the soul taking place right here. We call it sudden knowledge, sudden awareness, also called intuition. Intuitive knowledge. That means knowing something suddenly without thinking. We all have it. We all get it. But we ignore it. Why? Mind thinks, no, that's not possible. No, that's not. And 3 days later we say, I wish I had listened to my gut feeling. I wish I had listened to that. That's coming from the soul. Intuitive awareness is coming from the soul. We have it here. Mind dominates it and makes us not make use of it. Those who are enlightened and have seen where intuition comes from, they follow it. And they make the mind follow what the intuition says. What we do, we let the mind overwhelm the intuition and we follow what the mind says. We have become slaves of the mind. We souls have become slaves of the mind. And mind tells us what to do. Mind can be controlled, but we don't want to control it. We almost identified ourselves that we are the mind. There's no soul. I think, therefore I am. Biggest wrong statement. Correct statement is, I am, I have a mind, and I can use the mind to think. I use the mind to think. I have a mind. It's something I've got. It is not that I've become the mind. And yet, we are constantly feeling that I am thinking. I am not thinking. I is using the mind to think. So I, we have used as a personal egoistic entity as our own self. I is used in relation to the mind, not the soul, not our life. Life is general. We have made our life, even as an individual, as a general thing, this is all life. And who am I? I, the mind, the thinker. So we confused even our own self, who we are. The truth is, life individuated in us is the soul. And it has been given an accessory called mind. Very big difference between the way the mind functions and the soul functions. Soul functions intuitively, with joy, with bliss, with love. The mind functions by thinking, rationalizing, reasoning, making logic, making sense of things, putting the sensory perception together to make sense. Two different functions. They are not even overlapping. And yet we think everything is coming from the mind. We forget ourselves and we give credit to the mind for things that are actually happening in our soul. I came to this country first time in the 60s. I came to study at Harvard University, and the professors were also, some of them psychologists particularly, very interested in understanding the ultimate truth. So when I would share information with them, they would always have a bit of a controversy. Why is he saying this? So we had some kind of discussions, and they would not like to acknowledge that the soul is separate from the mind. They said, you know, soul, mind, whatever you're saying is our consciousness. I said, that's not true. Mind cannot operate even for one thought outside of space and time. There is no ability for the human mind, the thinking mind, to operate outside of time and space. Soul always operates out of time and space. Such a big difference right there. Intuitive knowledge comes without any time, without any space. It just comes and we know something. Mind has to think in time. The functions are very different. It took them so long to understand it. Of course, then they were experimenting, at least two professors I remember, were experimenting with drugs and mushrooms and whatnot. And they were expelled from the university, from Harvard University. One was Richard Alpert, who went to India. After that, he went to India. After these conversations, he decided to go to India. And I said, you'll find a lot of people in India telling you about intuitive functioning, more than mental functioning, which he never heard of earlier. And he went to Swami there and became Baba Ramdas. Ramdas, he called himself. And the Swami gave him the name. The other professor also went into the Pacific Ocean, set up an island, and set up a church of his own. And it was called the Church of the Boo-Hoo, because he declared in the church, there is no difference between the ridiculous and the sublime. So that's why he called that church. So these professors would discuss with me, everything can be generated by the mind, all that. One day, they said, look, do you believe, they asked me, do you believe that by hypnosis, by hypnotic activity, a person can be made to do things which is not even his own thinking? A hypnotist can create an artificial thing in you. artificial belief. A hypnotist can make you believe you are in heaven. I know that. Hypnotists have done that. He said, do you know there's an auto-hypnotism also? You can auto-hypnotize yourself. And that's what you are doing, they told me. What you are doing is, you are auto-hypnotizing yourself and believing there are true homes, such kinds, they are believing there are levels of awareness that you go, this all go there. It's all created by your automatically hypnotizing yourself into this belief. I said, it's possible. Why not? I understand about hypnotic activity, how it happens. Maybe I am auto-hypnotizing himself. It has not made much difference to my external life. I still got an A+ in your main paper. That means a good student. It didn't affect my studies here. And it doesn't affect my power to discuss things with you. I'm still alert and alive. But one difference is there between me, who has auto-hypnotized himself, and you. And that is, I am always happy. And you are taking antidepressants. Isn't that true? Which they were taking. You are depressed and unhappy. I am happy. Wouldn't you recommend that auto-hypnotizing to everybody? Then explain to them. Please give time to yourself, not to your mind. Time to yourself to understand who you are. And understand. And meditation, right meditation will lead you to that. What is meditation? Meditation, meditating upon something. That means thinking about something to start with. That's how we meditate on things, by thinking about it. Why not meditate on your own self? Then think about yourself. Not the body. Not senses. Yourself. Use your mind to think about yourself. Where am I? Who am I? Where am I operating from? Not mind, not body, not senses. Who am I? Where am I? I said, what will happen that way? You will start putting attention on yourself. And first step of withdrawal of attention will take place. And if you have a problem starting, I give you a head start. A head start is that if you want to know where you are, you can imagine where you are. Supposing I want you to say that you are sitting in that corner. I want you to do meditation sitting in the corner. You are not sitting there. You are sitting here. You can imagine for a moment that you are sitting there. This power of imagination that we have is coming from somewhere, a useful tool, a very useful tool to locate yourself. So why not imagine you are sitting in the center of the head, behind the eyes, at the very place where the self is actually operating from. We don't mix it up that you have to find a place. Where you are already sitting is exactly in the center of the head, behind the eyes, between the ears. If you imagine you are there, automatically you identify with the self. That's withdrawal of attention. So there are means and methods, technologies, to find out how to withdraw your attention to yourself. Meditation, the best meditation that will reveal to you what the self is meditating upon yourself and not what is outside of yourself. Even 1 inch away from you is not yourself. 1 centimeter away is not yourself. Where you are, that is yourself. Supposing in the course of meditation on yourself, what will happen? Something will be happening which happens when we concentrate our attention anywhere. Supposing I like these flowers and I start looking at these flowers and put my attention on the flowers. Attention means that I am not trying to look anywhere else except the flowers. And I concentrate my attention there. I will slowly not know where those flowers are. I certainly not know where you are, because all my attention is the flowers. Eventually, I'll only see the flower, nothing else. How is that possible? You are there, other flowers are there. This is the power of concentrating attention, that you can not only become more aware of what you are concentrating on, you can become less aware of what is away from it and ultimately become totally unaware of what is around it. Now imagine the value of putting attention on your own self. When you concentrate your attention on your own self, in the center of the head, what happens? You don't know what is outside. The longer you can put your attention, the more concentrated it is, you don't know that there is a, that you have limbs, that you have hands and feet. You become unaware of them. Then you become unaware of the rest of the body. Then you ultimately become unaware of the whole body. And you're still aware of yourself. Then you discover that when you are unaware of the physical body, you still have another body, but not this one. That's how you open up. And then the inner body looks like the soul. And now I found out the soul was running in this body. But that's not a soul, that's another body. Many people have stopped there thinking that's the soul. It is that inner body that transmigrates at death from one form to another form. It's not the soul that transforms. Some people think soul is moving from one body to another. The inner astral body, the sensory body, that moves. People call it soul because they don't know anything beyond that. But you can by meditating inside the inner body. Where? In the head of the inner body. Behind the eyes of the inner body. Exactly the same thing. You can make the inner body also not part of your awareness, and another body opens up, which is your mind. No form, only mind. Full perceptions, only mind. That's also your body. There are so many masters, and I've met many of them, who think once you find the mind, that's your soul and mind together. They have not gone beyond it. But they have not found the self. The self is still being confused with the mind. Because they are using a process of concentration with their meditation of thought only, they don't go beyond. There is no way that we can use the mind to go beyond the mind. And those masters have thought that is our true home. They call it universal mind, our true home. The whole universe is being created from there. A fortune is being created from there. But it's all in time and space. Not in the true home that we are seeking. Our soul is seeking something else. Mind can be satisfied, not the soul. Then soul is not satisfied. Then mind can do nothing. And soul still wants to go beyond that. Perfect living master comes and pulls us. Love comes from beyond the mind, and love pulls us beyond the mind, even there. So that is the secret, that no amount of meditation as we know it can ever take us beyond the mind. No meditation of any kind whatsoever has ever taken anybody beyond their own mind. It's all within their mind. The experiences are all within their mind. All experiences within time and space. All experiences, including experience of a void that comes up within time and space. Only the love of a master who then appears from inside pulling us takes us beyond the mind into our true home, where we really belong, where life itself belongs, where soul belongs. And that is possible. There are very few perfect living masters because there are very few seekers wanting that. But when you say there are billions of people living on the planet and very few seekers are there, that's because they are not seeking this true home. Those who are seeking their true home, perfect living masters appear in their case and they pull them by their love. This is a great experience to be pulled by love beyond your mind. Then you discover for the first time your immortality. Mind is not immortal. Mind has a very long life. In terms of physical years, they estimate the mind has a life of 3 to 5 million years. Even the inner body, the sensory system that exists in us, which is accompanied by the same mind, same soul, same mind, same inner body, moves at reincarnation, new physical body, the rest is still intact. Memories of that earlier body in the mind are carried forward. Even the way the perceptions take place are also carried forward. But when that also dies, inner body also dies, its average age is, say, by physical times, 1,000 to 3,000 years. That's it. You have got many astral bodies, many sensory bodies during the life of one mind. Mind also dies. Soul never dies, was never born, never dies. For the simple reason, there's no time there. If there's no time, when can you be born and die? Soul is immortal because it is surviving in a timeless state. That is why it cannot be born, cannot be dead. That is why it's immortal. People don't understand how immortality comes. If you had no time and space here, we were all here, we'd all be immortal. Right here. We live in time and space, past, present, and future. And that is why this is not a permanent place, this is temporary for all of us. Soul lives in a timeless state and therefore is immortal, never dies. Only when it comes into time, it is born through a mind and through a body and then dies. First this body dies, their inner body dies, their mind dies, soul never dies, it's immortal. Only when with the love of a perfectly master we are pulled beyond the mind, we discover our immortality. We talk about it here, but only experience it there. And there are several perfect living masters who have taken us to that level. Even amongst perfect living masters, there are those who have taken us to another step forward. Not only discovering who we really are, the immortal soul, they take us to our true home where we are all one. Not many souls. Many souls of one. One experiencing the many within itself. That's our true home. It's a remarkable experience to have of your true home. And then you discover that the whole thing, whole show of creation took place right there, not outside. There's nothing outside of our true home. Even now we are in the true home, unaware of it. Spiritual journey is not a journey in that sense. You don't go anywhere. It's not something sitting up in the sky, you're moving, flying up to go to somewhere. It's going within yourself to discover that your true nature, your true home is being covered by other experiences and deliberately created for change of experience. And then when you withdraw, you go back to your true home and discover everything happened there. And simple way to describe is, when we go to sleep and have a dream, we run around in the dream. Physical body is not running anymore. It's lying in bed. We go on far off, seeing new places, escaping from dangers, doing many things, running up and down, falling from places, all somewhere other than where we are sleeping. And then we wake up. When we wake up, we know we went nowhere, we were in the bed. Before we open our eyes, we know we went nowhere. It doesn't mean we open our eyes, where have we come now? Nobody does that. We know it is a dream created for a new experience of time and space, which was not connected with our physical awareness. We were still in the same bed. Now here we move all around, supposing we wake up again and find we were only in one place sleeping. And we created this like a dream. And then we say, at least we can move there, because it is still space and time. And then we wake up and find there was no space and time. We created it like a dream. We are always there. Then we find the manyness that we have created, the many souls, is also a dream. We wake up, there's only one dreamer. And these are series of six dreams. Can be explained like that. That is why sometimes they have called going to a higher level of awareness as awakening. There's like awakening to a level. And they don't say journey there. We call it journey because it's very easy to understand. It's far off. We have to go very far off. When I was young, very, very young, somebody explained to me the spiritual path. They said, spiritual path is that we belong to an ocean of souls. That was our true home. And we were some drops that left the ocean and have moved far away. So we are far away from our true home. And we are now little drops. And as drops, we are yearning to go back to our ocean. So spiritual path is for the drop to go back and merge in the ocean. That's how spiritual path was described to me. And I thought to myself, I am a drop. Sun shines, I get rainbow colors on me. I have friendship here, lot of nice people, all different here. I'm experiencing something great as a drop. What they're telling me is struggle hard to travel back all the way and go and merge in the ocean And then I am no longer who I am. I just merge in the water. And ocean doesn't care, one more drop has come into it. I gain nothing, I lose everything. Ocean gain nothing, it's a lose-lose game. The spiritual path is no good. I don't like it at all. But I was wrong. I didn't realize that the drop that I am never left the ocean. The drop was merely a contraction of the awareness of the ocean to a drop. And when the awareness expanded, it became a bigger drop, bigger ultimately, they realized it was the ocean. That's what the truth is. That means we never go anywhere. It's all happening in terms of awareness. How much we are aware of. We create a contracted awareness and become drops. How small are the drops? Here's a glass of water here with me. Are you to look at the water to understand spirituality? I said, there are drops. I would say, how small are the drops? I could make them very small. The population increased. I made them a little bigger. The population in the cup decreased. When I made them bigger, ultimately it became one drop, the whole cup, and it was only one. I say, I've understood the spiritual path. We are many because our conscious awareness has been contracted to the size of an individual being in time and space, captured here in a physical body. When our awareness expands, it captures more and more. It's a wider world. It's a bigger, real world, more real. Ultimately, when we reach, it's our true home in which the whole contraction took place, nothing outside. Nothing happened outside at all. It's not a game of going anywhere. It's a game of awareness, expansion, traction, awareness. Spiritual path is to be able to expand your awareness to totality and discover the total. These steps we take here are because we take the contracted situation as real. We take this world as real, which is, of course, a very artful thing we have done. We've done a very artful thing to make a simple change of experience into reality. How did we achieve this? Right now, we have no other reality except what we're seeing here, sitting together. I know I am real, you are real. Supposing I knew you are not real, what am I talking to? Who am I talking to? Supposing I had a dream and I was going to talk in the dream to people, I am not dreaming, I won't talk. They're dream creatures. But why am I taking you real? Because I'm taking myself real, taking everything real. All of us have one level of reality, physical reality. When we are in physical reality, this is the only reality. I'm talking of true home and all that. It's not real for us here. We may have it reality one day, but not real right now. At this time, there's only one reality. When we go to sleep and have a dream, the dream becomes the only reality. Supposing we know in the dream, it's a dream. And I've had such a dream. Many of you must have had. People tell me that they can know in a dream, it's a dream. What do we do when we know it's a dream? Tell everybody, you know it's a dream. Who are we telling to? When we wake up, nobody. We created them. And yet while the dream, knowing it's a dream, we still tell people it's a dream. That means we can speak the truth without really knowing the truth. And that's what we are doing here now. We're speaking the truth. But the reality has taken firm here. This is a beautiful, most wonderful miracle. How you can create a reality by shutting off all other levels of awareness and confining yourself to one level and become real. What is the test of reality? How do you know it's real? I want to know, is this glass in my hand real? I touch it. Yes, it's solid. Taste the water. Absolutely real taste. Absolutely real thing, everything. I just had experience of reality. How can I call it unreal? People say it's illusion, maya. I say no, I just tasted it. I touched it. It's real. Our definition of reality is, can we touch it, taste it, smell it, etc.? Now imagine, I'm sleeping and have a dream. I'm talking to you in the dream. And also table is sitting like this. In the dream, I am saying it's real. And I say, I can touch that glass. I can drink. And everything will happen the same way. And I'll say it's real. Then I wake up. No glass, no water. And I was calling it real. Because the experience of the sense perceptions were the same. This is a very secret way in which you can create reality that puts the sense perceptions of that level to match each other, and you say it's real. That's the only way we are making this reality real. There's no other way. There's no other proof whatsoever whether what we are seeing now is real or not, that we use one sense perception against another and say it's real. And we know we do the same thing in a dream and make it real. When we wake up, it becomes unreal. This state of reality will only become unreal when we wake up, not before that, when you go to a higher level. So this is a very wonderful, miraculous way to create levels of reality, not illusions. Why is it called? There was a famous dancer in India, a follower of Mahatma Gandhi, and she set up a dance school after Gandhi died. And somehow I was on a certain kind of a job where I had the chance to meet her, and I saw that performance, art form, where it comes from. They wanted to know art form, where it comes from. How do people become artists? So that was the subject. After that, she had a cup of tea with me. She said, if you know about Indian literature, Indian scriptures and so on, you have studied it, explain to me, why do we call this world Maya? Maya means illusion, not real. Why do we call a real world in all our scriptures, this is Maya, world of illusion? And it is not illusion. We are really seeing it. Everything looks real. So I gave her the same example. I said, when I have a taste of your cup of tea, the taste of the tea, my experience of holding the cup is real. Nobody can deny it. I had it. But because of that experience, I think the cup is real. That's the illusion. Maya is not referring to your experience. Maya is referring to the inference we draw from experience that because you had experience of things, things have to be real. No, experience is real. Things are not. It's a very subtle distinction. This is not illusion in the sense it's all unreal. The experience of the illusion is reality and beautifully created reality. And the illusion is we jump from the experience to thinking all the objects and people are also real. So it's a very subtle distinction. And it applies all the way to our true home. You'll see this as a reality has been created, and we can only experience one reality at a time. That's, otherwise, we would not make it real. Supposing I could also have my dream state right now, as I dreamt, this wakeful state also, higher wakeful state, all will become unreal. Nothing will look real. They'll all look like dreams. By shutting off everything else except one level, it becomes real. So that is why even when we go on our spiritual journey to a higher awareness, we move from one level of awareness to another, one reality to another reality. But what happens when we reach the top? All realities become one. Therefore, perfect living masters who come in our midst, they are seeing all realities together and know they are all illusions, and yet they are all realities at the same time. They function very differently than us. They look like us. They behave like us. But they are seeing things in a very different way. They know all realities have been created and all are created by the same power. What is that power that can create? The power to be aware of the reality, which is called consciousness. The secret is consciousness. Secret is that the ultimate totality of consciousness is our ultimate one soul, one power of creation. Totality of consciousness enables consciousness to be conscious of anything, and when it becomes conscious of one level of reality, it creates that through its own consciousness. Except We think that the thing has to be real before it can become conscious. That's our concept in the physical world. Old concept. People have discussed for thousands of years. Is the tree there because we are seeing it, or we are seeing it because it is there? Which is the causal direction? Does the tree cause the seeing of the tree, or seeing of the tree cause the tree to be there? Old discussion. Those who believe the tree has to be there before you can see it are called materialists. Those who believe the seeing of the tree is creating the actual tree are called idealists. The debate between materialists and idealists has never ended and probably will go on forever, because nobody has gone to see the source of all experience. When you go to source of all experience, you get answers to every question. But if you are sitting here discussing, the debate can go on forever. When you are in a forest, a tree falls, you can hear the tree falling. If you are not in the forest, do you still hear the sound? Or does the sound actually take place? Same issue. Not only about seeing, sound, touch, taste, smell. All these are sense perceptions. And do these perceptions take place and create what we are perceiving? Or things have to be there, created earlier before us, before we can perceive them? In this world, it's a world of karma, world of cause and effect. And they have divided cause and effect by time. What happens earlier is cause. What later is effect. That's the definition of cause and effect. They don't say effect comes first and then cause comes later. It's always cause first, effect later. They apply that rule to, is the tree comes first and then you see it? Or you see it and then the tree comes? They say, well, we place a tree in front of you, so tree has to be real before you can see it. The placing of the tree in front of you is also an observation like the tree. It makes no difference. If you say, is seeing the tree earlier than the tree? Now, measurement shows they are both exactly simultaneous. There is no time lag at all between the tree and seeing the tree. There is no time lag whatsoever, not even a nanosecond, between an experience of thing and the thing. That is why that cause and effect law doesn't operate here to explain the causal direction. Is the causal direction of our experiences in this world coming from outside impetus, coming into our sense perceptions or the physical body? Another question has been said by people who analyze it thoroughly, our sense of perception. Take one, it will apply to all perceptions. Eyes. We are seeing the world with our eyes. How do the eyes see? Materialists, doctors, physicians have been taught how we see. How do we see? Object appears and light falls upon the object. If you shut all the lights off, we won't see, eyes won't see. Eyes cannot see in darkness. In total darkness can see nothing, therefore light is needed. All right? So when light falls upon an object, the light is reflected. Not all of it. Light has seven basic colors, colors of the rainbow. White light has all the colors. So the white light falls on our dress, and if you're wearing a red colored shirt, it means all the other colors are absorbed by the shirt. Red cannot be absorbed, therefore it looks red. That's the scientific explanation of color. Color means that which cannot be absorbed by an object. When the object absorbs all other colors of the light, red cannot be absorbed, it's reflected back. So I am looking now at a red color. Rays near parallel rails are coming from the red color of the shirt to me, and they strike my eyes. And there are a few things like an aqueous humor, vitreous humor, liquids, one thicker, one finer, and a lens. They invert the image and put an inverted image of that red shirt into the retina of my eyes. What is retina? Retina is an extension of the optic nerve that comes from the brain. The optic area of the brain sends out these retina and the nerves. The retina has rods and cones that give the color and shape, and we can see the shirt and the red. It's transmitted by the optic nerve to the optic area in the brain. And there, if you are awake and conscious, you see the shirt. If you are not conscious, you can't see the shirt. The rest of the process can be the same. If you are sleeping and your eyes open, you can't see the shirt because you're not conscious in the brain. If you're conscious in the brain, you see. Now, let us imagine that the power to create images has been vested in the retina. And the retina creates that image by itself and sends a message to the brain. We will see that red shirt exactly as we are seeing now, because the rest of the process is exactly the same. Supposing retina does nothing, it's only the optic center in the head that can create a red shirt. Like it is experiencing, it will immediately create an object opposite on the retina, and also we see the red shirt outside. Supposing it's only consciousness which ultimately picks it up, and consciousness itself creates the red shirt, the optic area in the head will have the red shirt, the optic nerve will carry it, it will have an inverted image of the shirt in the retina, and we see the retina there. Have we established which does consciousness create it, or the shirt is creating it? No proof, they are simultaneous. Can any proof be found about it? Can we do some kind of dissection of the brain and see? They have done thousands of surgeries of the brain, can't find anything in the brain. Gray matter, synaptic things in which electric lines are flowing. No idea how this whole process is taking place. But there's another way of finding out. If by concentrating attention inside the center of the brain, from where most of the brain is functioning, where all the hormones of the whole body are functioning from one direction in a very small organ called the pituitary body, to next to that is a small little gland called pineal gland. They are already in everybody's head, they are there. And they are responsible for thoughts emanating and going into the different parts of the brain. They are the ones which are telling us what to do. They are the ones controlling how we can use our muscles, how we can use this. If in that area, we can concentrate our attention, that very area, and create red shirts wherever we like, we will know that's where the red shirts were created. We'll have some proof. What we are doing as empirical science, empirical medical science, is not willing to do that. They say empirical means externally in the world we should have proof, outside. Something that we are examining, consciousness, cannot be examined by that system. They're trying to examine something, how is the person conscious? In India, I was working in a state government, and a great leader of another country visited us and had a car accident and got into a coma. Since he was a dignitary of another country, we were very worried what will happen. They'll think we might have killed him or something. So a lot of investigation was done. Long-term coma. We got the best surgeons from all over the world, brain surgeons, to come and examine so what treatment they can give. So brain surgeons came and examined that man, long coma. And I remember my boss, who was the chief minister of the state, he said, "Doctor, tell me one thing. Where does consciousness come from?" And that big surgeon would open more than 1,000 brains in his surgery, said, "Sir, that's a question we have not been able to find an answer to. We have tried for thousands of years." And the answer of the doctor, famous doctor, he said, "All we know is that we can deactivate the power of seeing in the brain by going to the optic area and putting a laser beam on it and deactivating it, and it can stop seeing, we can deactivate. If we put our laser beam on that pituitary body right at the center, we can make a person unconscious. They have a consciousness. Whatever it is, we don't know what it is. Whatever it is, we know it has something to do with that area. That's what the doctor said. What is meditation? To meditate on the self which is operating in the wakeful state from that very area. That's exactly the area from where we are all operating right now. We're looking at each other, we're looking at it, we are listening, looking, listening, attending, everything is taking place, that one single area. And that's the area where consciousness resides. So therefore, unless we go and examine there what the causal effect and causal direction is, we can never find it from outside. But if you go there, you'll find the causal direction. It's from inside out, which defies us because the reality has been created in such a way we think outside has to be real before we can experience it. It's very difficult for us to understand that experiencing is taking place and that's creating the reality outside. Very difficult for us to understand. Reality has been so well established. But if you move from one reality to another frequently through deeper meditation, then becomes clear that we create realities ourselves right from inside, from consciousness. So consciousness is responsible for this. I have shared these things with you because these can come to your experience. I'm not saying believe anything I say. Don't believe a single word unless you can experience it. One of the fundamental part of the teaching of my master. No scope for blind faith whatsoever. This is totally experiential. This is totally to be experienced. Only believe what you experienced. If you experience more, believe more. But don't disbelieve because somebody else has experienced and I haven't. That don't make that mistake. Because I haven't experienced, it doesn't exist. A lot of people take that attitude. You say you experienced that. No, I haven't experienced, doesn't exist. No, you haven't experienced. You go by your experience. And no blind faith. If something pulls you from inside, try to go inside. It's not blind because pulling is taking place inside. Then go inside. If you go within yourself in meditation and see something, believe what you see. Not what somebody else says. There's no place for hearsay. We see something, we go one step. Then the second step we can take. Because first one came out right. If the second comes out right, we can take a third one. That is how we move in higher awareness of our own self. It's a very practical thing. It's open to all human beings. It is not for any particular group of people. You can belong to any country, any nation, any culture whatsoever. You can have any faith. You can belong to any religion you like. Religions are based upon some statements made by the founders of religions, and we want to take them for granted. It's a blind faith. If you have blind faith, keep that aside and experiment to find the reality through going within your own self. Fortunately, every religion also says that you go within. The kingdom of God is within you. Everything, truth is inside you. They happen to say the same things. But even if they say same things, just believing that is not good enough. Experiencing it is good enough. Therefore, go within and you find out. How many of you have come here because you saw me or my picture on a YouTube video? So many. I would like to say I am feeling sad that the person who created my images on YouTube video, Mark Kazmierczak, passed away. He died. I'm sorry. And apart from offering condolences to his wife, who is present here, Claudia, I want to offer my condolences for this thing. I also want to say that he had done a very good job and he was taken good care of by my master. And he's in very good shape right now. This is one of the things that I have seen. I have seen hundreds of people dying. Those who were initiated by a perfect living master were not met by angels of death or somebody. They were met by their master when they died. Very often, few moments before they died, they could tell. Sometimes they couldn't tell, tongue-tied at the last moment, but their eyes expressed that some master has come. But this is one of the guarantees of initiation by a perfect living master, that he breaks our normal procedure of rebirth, normal procedure of reincarnation and carrying on from one life's causes to another life's effects, karmic law. He appears and decides whether you need another life or not, whether you can fulfill any obligations you have under the law of karma, which is a very big subject. I'll talk to you, I think, about it later. And that how you are going to be taken into another life, what will be decided, where you will pick up that karma from the last life. Master decides that, and not any other agency. Ordinary people die, and there is a setup by which an angel of death or a soul given that particular position because of its own karma is working on some kind of a computer to tell you, this was your karma, go down on this, there's a new combination. It can be many life forms also. I'll talk to you about it maybe tomorrow, explain to you fully how the law of karma operates and how our lives are, how destinies are made. Why is somebody poor? Why is somebody rich? Why somebody born here, somebody born there? Why somebody born in the United States, somebody born in Africa? What makes these things happen? Are we responsible for karma? Is somebody imposing it on us? All those questions come up. I'll deal with them tomorrow. Today, I'll break now. You have a nice lunch break. And I will come back and meet you about 3 o'clock again. If you have any questions on what I have just said, or any questions on what I have not said, they will give you the advantage of some pencil and paper, write them down, and in the afternoon session, I'll take up your questions. And I hope you enjoy your lunch, and I hope we'll continue this subject of this true spiritual path to our true spiritual home during the 3-day event that I am here with you. Thank you very much for very patiently listening to my long talk. I should have spoken a little less, but I don't know, something happens. They speak too much. I was telling somebody today morning that somebody gave me an old talk of mine on YouTube. It just went on and on. I said, how long is it going to be? And as it happened, it shows how many hours and minutes it lasting. 2 hours and 15 minutes. I said, shut it down. How can anybody put up for that long? I said, there should be some control mechanism. Then we decided in Davis, Northern California, where I was there, that somebody will wave to me. And that person never waved. So we have to have some control mechanism, otherwise I talk too much. The reason is I want that I look upon you as my very close friends. I don't see you as strangers at all. I don't get that feeling. So I feel what I've got, you should all get. At least, if not anything else, I've got happiness. We're all looking for happiness. There's no greater happiness you can get than the happiness of total knowledge. When you have knowledge inside, what happens is there is no doubt. The clarity is such, no doubt. When there is no doubt, there is no fear. Imagine if you have no doubt, you never have fear. Fears come from doubts. Fears come from unknown. That may happen. This could happen. But when you can see, there is no fear. So your very life in this world changes just with these two factors. So that is why I want all of you to be totally fearless by discovering your own true self. And when you will discover the own true self, you'll find you and I are the same. We come from the same source and we are one. Thank you very much. See you later.